Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. It's always good to be in the house of the Lord. It's always good to come and let God know how good he's been to you. How good has God been to you today? Oh, wonderful. Wonderful. One of the things that I really enjoy is that at that time I go back and forth to work, and you know, it's a time to just let God kind of soak your day, you know, in his goodness. And one of the songs that I just remember most was Great is Thy Faithfulness. That is one of my all-time favorite songs. And one year I was going through some things years ago, and it was after midnight. It was so quiet, I did not realize I even had my radio on in the vehicle. And I definitely didn't know it was on that station. And it was no static, no nothing, and all of a sudden, out of the speakers came this chorus. I mean, it came from nowhere, and I know what God was speaking to me. And it was, Great is Thy Faithfulness. And I just want to share a few. I just love this song. Great is Thy Faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not. How powerful is that? The same Jesus, that's what we got to remember. The same Jesus. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Yes. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, soon sun, moon, and stars and the courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. We need to never forget that. Never, ever forget that. Every day, you're given another opportunity to praise God. And when we think about how good God is, remember, I love to go in Isaiah 61, because we know Jesus said this in Luke, but it says, the Spirit of the Lord God, it's Isaiah 61, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed and qualified me to preach the gospel of the good tidings of the meek, the poor and afflicted. He has sent me to bind up and heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the physical and spiritual captives, yes, and the opening of the prison, and the eyes to those who are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, the year of his favor, yes, hallelujah, and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, hallelujah, to grant consolation and joy, to give those who mourn in Zion, to give them an ornament, a garland of diadem, a beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, the garment expressive of praise instead of heavy burden and failing spirit, that they may be called oaks of righteousness, lofty, strong, and magnificent, distinguished for uprightness, justice, and right standing with God, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. We want to never forget. We know sometimes our lives can get where it just seems like they're just full of ashes. There's so much stuff going wrong. But God can make beauty come out of that. God can turn those situations around that you thought, there's no way. But I always remember one thing, what Jesus said. I am the way. You know, people ask me, I used to see people that involved in a lot of, there's a negative things. And Tim, which way should I go? Which way should I go? You always point them to Christ. You know, I may not have all the answers, but one thing I do know is I know the answer person. I know the answer God that can take care of those situations. That's the best thing you can do for somebody, is invite them to church. Invite them to God. Invite them to know. One time I ran in, it was out today, and sometimes I run into some of the older students that have graduated, and now they got their trucks. To see that smile on their face, one was just driving by. He was backed into a dock, and he was waving, saw our DMAC truck go by, and then he's pointing to his truck, And it's like, yeah, we helped him get there. We helped him along the way. That's what God does for your life. He helps you. He gets your life straightened out. Doesn't mean your life is perfect, but he helps you to be able to help somebody. The Bible talks about he gives you that comfort so you can comfort somebody else. I tell you, there's something that you cannot deny when you can say this and somebody asks you, I've been through that. And you can say, yeah, I've been there too, but I come out on the other side. See, that's powerful. You know, people can argue, you know, that you get people that argue doctrine over here and then doctrine about this point and that point. But I tell you what, they can't argue one thing, and that's what happened to me. Yeah. So you can't argue that. Yeah. And the blind said, I was blind, but now I see. Now they can argue all that fact, but now I can see. Yeah. I remember. Mm-hmm. I remember. That's why the past is good for one thing, and that's to not ever forget where you came from. Not to go back and dwell there, but know where you came from. I think some people forget. You know, one thing, and I know I say this over as an instructor, one thing that always keeps me grounded is I never forget I was new. Never forget that. Because it can be applied the same in Christian. You can get so far, you know, you keep going in God and going in God, and then you get a new Christian that is just learning to walk. It's like, you know, I've never, you know, when you see the baby, we look at a baby, you know, they make small steps. You know, I mean, he learned to set up a little bit and roll over and head up, you know, but I've never yet seen a baby crawl and then all of a sudden pull himself up and run across the room. Yeah. I've never, ever seen that happen. Why? Because it's a process. And it's the same way with Christians. You know, they take a while to get there. Let them get there. The best thing you can do is encourage them along the way, you know, and say, brother, you know what? I'm going to lock arms with you. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to help pray with you, and I'm going to be there for you. You need, I will direct you right here. That's where my guidance comes from, you know, and I can tell you what. I can tell you what happened in my situation. One thing, I've been through those things. I've cried those tears, but I know one thing. God can bring you out. You know, that's what I love about Jesus, you know. It's like, you know, some people, they wanted to see Jesus so bad, they would push through the crowd. And sometimes that's what we need to do, push through all the stuff that's going around. Just think, always think about the woman that you know, she spent all of her money, the issue of blood, you know, I mean, you know, and I know people can get frustrated. I've been to every doctor. I've been to Mayo Clinic. I've been to this and been to that. It's not getting better. I have no more money. The insurance runs out. And somewhere she must have heard, if I can just get to Jesus, must have heard that. And I tell you, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, that's all I'm going to do. If I can, I know it's going to heal. Something's going to happen. And you're pushing to the crowd. I've been in football games where there's 60,000 people in the stadium. And, you know, they're, you know, all trying to get out after the game. And there's a lot of people pushing. But you know if somebody touched you in a certain way. It's not just the crowd pushing, but somebody's reaching out. You know, there's a difference there. And that's what, you know, the disciples said. What Jesus said, you know, who touched me? He said, you know, it's like they were natural men, you know. Yeah. Who touched you? Man, I mean, there's everybody pushing up against you. Said, no, you don't understand. Virtue went out of me. Some healing went out of me. There was something different. And there she was right there. And I love that the lady just fell down. And, you know, it's just like, you know, and she just let it all out. Let it all out. And she got healed that day. She shared it. You know, hey, I spent all my living. I don't have nothing, but I come to you. And I love the song when it says, just as I am. Just as I am. That's the way God wants you. It's always that way. Amen. You know, it's not, you know, in some religions, they want you to clean up first and then get right with God. It doesn't work that way. God wants you to come just as you are. And then he starts working. And God always works from the inside out. He's always working in here. Right? Because he wants us, we're ambassadors. Ambassadors, you represent the country you got sent from. Uh-huh. That's what you are. And we're ambassadors of Christ. Yeah. That's what we represent. And just think, and that's what I love. You know, when you put on, when I'm at work and I got to wear a shirt and I'm in that truck out there, that's who I represent, the school. That's who I, everywhere I go. So it makes a difference how I turn the truck and how we're driving out there. Because if not, somebody might call. I understand that part. You know, and it makes a difference. Now, here we are Christians. We're representing the God of glory. We're representing him. So everything we say and do ought to reflect Christ. You know, we used to say, what would Jesus do? You know, we have a board game. Actually, it's got that on there. And it's got situations. What would Jesus do? It's really more than that. What would Jesus do? What would Jesus say? How would Jesus act? I mean, there's a lot of things. And I tell you what, it'll really cause a lot of change in this if we think about what comes out. You know, because people say, oh, I'm just going to say what's on my mind. Maybe we ought to think about what's on our mind before it comes out, because words cannot be taken back. Right. And when we represent Christ, somebody says, are you a Christian? That's an easy response. I'm not going to hem-haw around. You bet I am.
Yeah. Come on.
I believe in the Lord of glory because he changed my life. And you know what? God's here tonight and said, you know, great is thy faithfulness. Mm-hmm. I'm with you. The same Jesus that died on the cross, the same one. You remember when Jesus was taken up, you know, and they were still gazing, you know, and the angels was there. And they said, this same Jesus you see go, he's going to come in like manner. The same Jesus. And that's what we got to always remember. The same Jesus that died on the cross, that one that provided your healing, he's still the same Jesus today. He still heals today. He still delivers today. And he's there, still here for you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's God. It's God. So we're going to open this time up. I asked to pray for one of our students had a request, and his dad had some issues. And you know, I love it when I hear that. And, you know, can I pray for you? Well, I think that is such a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer, and you can pray for another person. But you're going to take your time out. And like I said before, I haven't remember too many people ever rejecting that. I have known too many people that say, no, I really don't appreciate you praying for me. It's always the opposite. You know what they say? Thank you. Thank you for doing that. Thank you for taking it to the throne. And I believe 100%. I'm not going to waste my time praying. I believe it's actually going to change things. I believe that. It's not going to go just to the ceiling. You know, I put a lot on Facebook, people and ones that own it that know. Two words I've been putting really for about the last year when somebody asked me, prayer. Prayer's up. That's what, you know, I just write those two words. Prayer's up. Prayer's up. Prayer's up. Because I believe the prayers go all the way up to the throne room. And God, I love the fact, you know, one thing I got to share this last part. I had my granddaughter, when she was little, she had a hearing issue. And almost she had to raise your voice quite a bit for her to hear you. But there's two things I noticed about her is that there's two ways I could get her to, so we could hear each other. She eventually had a little surgery and everything's fine now. Was I had to do one or two things. First one, I either had to get down like this on her level, right here, or I had to lift her up. She's only a few years old, and we was looking face to face. And I remember doing that, you know, and once we got face to face, and I raised her up, thought, wow, that's it, you know, because God raised us up. God did both, because
yeah.
Jesus came down,
yeah.
But he also raised us up,
yeah, right.
So we can be face to face, and I love that. You know, I remember... We used to have, she always wanted to have tea, you know, little girl. She's like two or three. Grandpa, you want to have tea with me? Well, you know, I couldn't sit on those chairs she had, let me tell you. We had a little issue with that. So, you know, with the seats about that big, they got to fit. But, you know, you got down on her level. I had to sit on the floor. But you know what that meant? That meant the world to that little girl.
Sure, yes, it did.
That's what it meant. She remembers that today. Yeah. Oh, I got little cookies for you. And little, you know, she could. But that meant a lot to her. And you know what? God knows what means a lot to you.
That's right.
Those prayers you've been wanting God to things in your life, don't ever give up on.
Amen.
You know? Because I'm telling you, the very time we give up, if we would just go a little bit farther. Some people give up so close. And God just saying, go a little bit farther. Just think, Jesus was obedient to the death of the cross. He was all the way in. I always feel the victory was won when Jesus was in the garden.
That's, right.
That's where the victory
That's
was
right.
done.
That's right.
And it always impressed me that he wanted man to pray with him. That is so powerful. Can't you guys pray with me? Don't you realize all the sins, past, present, and future, got to get dumped on me. I always get that image of Jesus. I have a big vat of oil, And I had a perfectly white cloth getting ready to get dumped in there. So it's going to be all stained and all that. And all this is getting ready to come. Can't you pray with me? But his statement, you know, nevertheless, not my will, but thine, your will, Lord. And once he surrendered to God, we're ready now. Bring it on. Yeah. We're going. Yeah. And that's where, when we surrender to God 100%, Jesus didn't let nothing back. He surrendered the whole thing. And that's where I see the changes in our lives. When we give God 100%. I remember being in church in Springfield, Virginia, out there, and this lady gave a testimony. She said, one thing we have to do, we have to give it all to God. Sometimes we have in our minds, we have little rooms that we don't want anybody to enter. It's like we have the door chained and barred. We don't want anybody in there. But she said the only way is to let God totally take your life and go in that room and clean it out. Yep. So you can be a whole person. God wants all of you to serve. Every part of your life, he wants dedicated to him. Because then that's where the change comes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're going to go ahead and open this testimony up, time up. So. Yes, Mike. Right.
And Cindy, I don't know where Tammy and Roberta are. I've looked them up. Sheila, Traveling Mercies, growing up in New Jersey.
Yeah.
I watch over her. Something I read this afternoon also, it was in a Pew report talking about the declining church attendance and stuff all over the nation and stuff like that. And I inquired of the Lord. I said, Lord, is your spirit wanting to move? He says, yes, this is exactly why. The attendance or the church is not dying. He says religion is dying.
Right.
I want to rise up my bride.
Right.
What man has created over the last few hundred and few thousand years.
Right.
2,000 years. He says the man's church is dying. Religion is dying. Doctrine is dying.
Right.
And sometimes things have to die before, it's like in a fire or a forest fire. I mean, everything gets burnt down. And
right. Amen.
He says, don't be discouraged. He says, I'm working in this and my spirit is moving.
Hallelujah. So
praise the Lord.
Yeah, that's where it's at. God is doing a new thing. With people are dedicated. It's just, you see how God is getting people serious about him. You know, the reason religion doesn't work, because religion, we know that religion is man's effort to get to God. You know, and being spiritual is God's effort to get to man. Like he reached down. His arm is not too short that he can't save.
Right.
You know, he's always reaching out. Think about it. God's always reaching out to you. You know, when people get saved, if you look how it was steps, a lot of times it was steps. One person said this to them. You know, like the Bible says, Paul planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. Yeah. You know, it's like there's different steps, and God's continually drawing people. You know, it's just like you don't give up on your kids. They may be way out here, away from the Lord. You know, it may be grandkids or whatever, but you know what? You keep praying for them. You keep believing. And said, God, send somebody over to the house. And be surprised, you know. Somebody that, it may be a neighbor. It may be somebody that just stopped and shared their testimony. And then all of a sudden they call you up, you know. Hey, guess what happened to me today, Grandpa? I remember my grandson did. Guess what happened? He said, I went down the altar. He went down on his own. And he said, you know what? My heart doesn't hurt anymore.
Woo.
That was all his. Nobody forced him to go. He walked that aisle by himself. That was that result of people praying for him. That's what God wants us to do. Don't ever give up on people. We always remember a thief on the cross. People say, well, you know, Tim, his life wasn't very good because he wasn't a very good. There wasn't much testimony. He didn't have a chance to go to Evangelism Explosion or learn all the Bible. He didn't have a chance to do all those programs. But how many people have been saved because of that thief on the cross that said, hey, it's not too late. It's not too late because Jesus was there. Remember me, Lord. Please remember me this day. This day, you're going to be with me. That is so powerful. Buddy, that's cutting her pretty close, let me tell you. You know, I mean, a little bit longer. He was gone out to turn it without knowing. But he said, remember me. And that's what, there was people praying. You know, there was a grandma or mom people praying. I don't even know where he's at, but save him, change his life, and right there at the cross. So he's been a testimony for years and years and years, and there's a lot of people who got saved because of that thief on the cross. So we're never going to give up. Never going to give up. Someone else. Yes. Right.
Sunday I was prayed for by arm, and it's good.
Hallelujah.
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 It works.
Yeah. That's right. Praise God. Don't ever stop. Don't ever stop praying. I was out driving students, and the rail cars that fixed the rail, and this is how God does. Okay, God can tell you to stop. He can tell you to go forward. He can tell you to, you know, just to pause. So we stopped at the railroad tracks west of the yard, and the first rail vehicle came through. And then the arms start going up and lights. I said, don't move. There's usually two.
Right.
There's usually two of them coming. And the car was coming east, didn't move. So I know they saw it. We couldn't see it as clear. I said, don't move. And here comes the second one. Okay, and if we'd started across them tracks, man, I mean, they would have got us and the rail and all, the arms and everything. But when God puts it on your heart and he says, don't, listen to what God, he's trying to protect you. Uh-huh. You know, I don't want him ever have a phone call that this disaster happened because he didn't listen. And I'm in that field. I mean, 1 second can make all the difference. But when God, when you have God inside of you, you know, that still small voice, a lot of times he can tell you no. He can tell you, just wait, just wait, just wait. Because it's a lot better to pray before the fact than after the fact than to ask God to clean it all up after you done messed it all up. When he would have said, hey, if you would have waited. Now, God's gracious. His mercy new every day. I've seen him still, you know, like we talk about, still, you know, take all his ashes and make beauty. I've seen God do it. But wouldn't it have been better if we would have listened to God at the first? Hallelujah. 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 Someone else. Someone else.
Okay. Tim, I was just going to say,
yes.
You were reading from Isaiah 61.
Yes, sir.
Jesus is telling us what he's here for, what his purpose was.
Right? Hallelujah.
And look at John 20:21. He says, as my Father has sent me, so send I you.
Hallelujah.
We get born again, we have the same anointing, the same call.
That's right.
The same purpose. And that's exactly what you're talking about. When you're reaching out to people, when you're trying to minister to people, we're simply obeying what Jesus was sent here to do and then what he in turn sends us to do as a result.
Hallelujah.
So our job is pretty easy to understand. If you go to Isaiah 61, you can find it real quick.
That's right. That's
all we got to do. Do what he was doing. Reach out to those that are in darkness, those that are blind and can't see, those that can't hear, those that are lame, those that are not able to get to God. It's a means by which we can present God to them.
Thanks for sharing that, Pastor. And you know, that is really the best thing you can do. Because, you know, we can look at a person sometimes, you know, and you know, they might be dressed this way or that way, and you think, well, they don't have needed nothing. We don't know where they're at.
That's right.
We don't know. Sometimes the most well-dressed person is going through a lot of stuff, you know. And the person we looked at that may not look the way we thought. And then, you know, man, their life's together. You know, some people just like looking certain ways.
Yeah.
But it's not ours. God knows the heart. The Spirit can identify. And I tell you what, you can never go wrong. As an old preacher told me, Tim, you can never talk to the wrong man about God. How are you going to do it? You know? And the best thing, the reason I became a Christian was simply because I was invited to church. That's where it started at. Mm-hmm. There wasn't no doctor or nothing. Come. Hey, they have a revival down there. They have a young people's night. Come, Tim. Come, Tim, they're just preaching. I don't remember that night what the whole sermon was about. I don't remember that at all, except he talked about the blood of Jesus.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's what I remember. Mm-hmm. And I remember that he walked all the young folks up, and he had a handkerchief. And as it came toward me, I don't remember saying, God, forgive me. I don't know what. I just know that something changed in my heart. It changed so radically because I hadn't been going to church at that time for a few years. I'd gone some when I was, you know, younger. But it's like it changed me so radically. I went home that night, got me a garbage bag, went in my room and start throwing out all the stuff that I knew wasn't pleasing to God.
Mm-hmm.
Mom came in, what are you doing, Tim? I'm cleaning house. That's what we're cleaning house, and we're going to church on Sunday. Because I knew something was different. Right. My eyes opened, I knew that God had touched me. Didn't understand it all, but I knew that from that point on, I want to do my best to please God with my life from that point on. That change come. When that change come, I knew it was different. Still had the same, you know, you're still the same height, same shoe size, but you changed from the inside out.
Amen.
And from that day, I looked, my life changed. And, you know, we used to sing a song in church, yes, Lord, so say yes. We used to sing that a lot. Well, I tell you what, my soul's been saying yes ever since then, but I'm still going to be walking. Even if you have the dark days and everything, we're still going to stay on the rail. The rail train goes nowhere. Right? It's not going to go nowhere until it gets up on the track, and then straighten the track out, and it's still running. And that's how we're going to get there. Just stay on the track. Stay with Jesus, and he'll get you to the finish line.
Amen.
Hallelujah. 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 So I'm going to, yes, brother. Hallelujah.
So I drove up there, and I'm praying in the spirit, and asked the Lord, what do you want me to say? And so he told me what to tell him. He said, so when I got in there, I said, hey, God told me to tell you, he knows that your heart has been tremendously hurt by a man in your life. And when he laughed, the laugh was that real mocking, kind of a demonic, curdling sound.
Yes. Yep, and we appreciate you being obedient and going in there, because the one thing about it, you planted seed, because they're listening to you. They might not, you know, show any outward signs, but I'm telling you what, that word gets into it. That word gets into it. I was in a place in my life, and this young man, and I asked him, he was probably about 12 years old, and he came by me, and I wasn't doing some the where I should have been, and I asked him how he was doing. I'm blessed. I remember him walking by me. I'm blessed. You know, I kept hearing that kid's voice. I'm blessed.
Yeah.
I'm blessed. I'm blessed. And I tell you what, if you realize you're blessed, you want to live a righteous life and a holy life, even if you get off track. Because the Bible says all the disciples forsook them and fled. All of them did.
Yeah.
I mean, they fled means they run. But you know, they come back. Isn't that something?
Yeah.
They come back. And I love Jesus, especially Peter, who said, you know, I'll stand by him. You know, I'll do all this. And, you know, he denied him three times. Isn't it interesting that when Jesus rose from the dead and they got back together, he didn't say to Peter, you know what, I don't appreciate that at all. I really don't appreciate you treating me like. He didn't. You know, I love you.
Yeah.
You know, if that love came out.
That's right.
You know, because, you know, God knows our failings. He knows where we're at.
Yeah.
But you know what? God says, you know what, I'm going to love you anyway. It's, you know, it's like the prodigal son. When the son came back, the son had this big speech, and it's like the dad wasn't even wanting to listen to the speech, you know. He said, you know, you're home. You're home. That's what he was thinking. You come home. He realized, you know, his dad had been praying, had dad had been looking. But you know what? You're home. And you tell you what? Put the ring on his finger. Shoes on his feet. Fatted calf. That's what we're going to do. We have a celebration.
Yep.
Because you're home and you're mine. And you never, ever stop being my son. Hallelujah. Never did. Anybody else? Okay. Can we go ahead and stand for prayer? Oh, hallelujah. Lord, we thank you so much that we can come in your house. Lord, we thank you for our brother going to get and go. We thank you for being obedient. For that obedience. Hallelujah. That your word won't return void. Hallelujah. That, Lord, those seeds that are sown, one day we're going to believe that that's going to come into fruition. Because it got sowed on good ground. We don't know where that young man was. But we know, hallelujah, that there was a reason for them guys meeting at this time. Whether he moves down to Oklahoma, have somebody already there, that's going to do the same thing, is going to talk to him. Hallelujah, and change a life. Lord, we ask you to be with James' friend and those health situations. Lord, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, that we can come and pray for those that wasn't able to be here tonight. Be with Myron, Lord. Continue to heal him. Lord, we want to thank you for the fact that we can come and lift the members of the church. We ask you to be with our children, our grandchildren, our neighbors. Lord, that Lord, let that change always start with us. Let our heart always get bigger in you, that people can see that we have spent time with you. Just like Moses that spent time had to put a veil on his face because he shined so much. And Lord, we want to tell you tonight that we love you, that we appreciate you, and let us always be obedient for your cause. Like David said, God, is there not a cause? Yes, there's a cause. The cause is Jesus Christ. That is the cause. And hallelujah, Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Our desire is to know you, Lord. Lord, that's what it's going to be. We want to know you more and more and more, deeper and richer and fuller. Lord, that your mercies are new every day. We have a new start. We have a new life every morning. We get another opportunity. We are alive for a reason. Let us be used by you in a mighty way. Lord, we ask you just to bless this service tonight. Let it change us so that when we leave, we will not be how we came in here. That there will be something different that will be illuminated in our soul. And Lord, we thank you tonight. We praise you tonight. In your wonderful holy name, we pray amen and amen. Hallelujah. All righty. Okay. We're going to speak the word. First, make sure our phones are off. Okay, let's speak the word. Will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? Hallelujah. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the Word of God. Hallelujah. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servants, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Brother Eric, would you come and take the offering for us, please? You may be seated.
Church, it's kind of funny, and this pastor that was there opened the door and invited him in, and Todd basically was really angry and telling him all this stuff, you know, just like letting it all out. That pastor that was there happened to be a guy named Dan Moeller, and so it was interesting because Todd White called his daughter after that, after he talked to Dan Moeller, and basically he was arguing with him against Christianity. Finally, he goes, you know, I'm just going to, my life's over, I'm giving it up tonight. He goes, well, why don't you just give it to Jesus, man, if you're done with it.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So it was kind of a funny thing. But anyway, so he called his daughter, and he goes, you know, I got saved tonight. And the daughter's like, oh, Daddy, blah, blah. And he goes, she said something to him, makes it effect. What he said was that I saw Jesus in this man's eyes. And so that is, like Tim was saying tonight, you know, that's that radical call God's got right now. Where he's at, he's calling us. You know, before the church, we learned all about power, authority, all these things. But now, it means God's bringing it around again because we missed it. He's bringing it around again. He's like, let's inject love in here. Let's get all these things straight. Let's be transformed in the image of Christ. And because all these promises we talk about are in Jesus.
Right.
You know?
Right.
You know, it's great. This morning, I had this revelation. I was sitting out, actually letting my dog out. So I sit out and drink coffee. My dog just retrieves the dummy. So I throw it, she brings it back, you know. Anyway, so I was sitting there thinking, you know, we know in 1 John it says God is love, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I always wondered, when Satan's talking to Adam and Eve, he goes, you know, because God's like, don't eat of this tree, because you will die. And Satan's like, surely you're not going to die. Well, I always wondered what that means. Well, we learn in 1 John, God is love, right? Well, Adam was created in God's image,
right,
which means outside and inside image. So Adam was created to be loved. So his identity was love.
Right.
Well, in the original sin, the love died. Pastor Nathan was talking about that last Sunday. What happened? The darkness, the death. I mean, all those words are equated.
Right.
You know, selfishness, the self. And so when he said, you will die, it was totally true because his whole identity died. He lost his whole identity, which was God, which was love. And so, anyway, that's what Jesus came, not just to, you know, get us an insurance policy, you know, for someday to go to heaven. Jesus came to recreate us, to reconnect us with God's love.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so that was our creative purpose.
Right.
And that's why you'll hear Dan Moeller, you'll hear Todd White, you know, say, well, I see God's creative purpose in people, and I can, you know, see him the way God sees us because we've all been created to be beings of love. And we understand that about everybody. Sin's not the problem. It's not yelling at everybody because they're sinning. It's that everyone needs to get reconnected to God's love. So anyway, I mean, that's the video. And basically it's about, you know, why are we sitting around? Why are we living so low with our lives? You know, why are we living emotion to emotion? Why are we really living a carnal life, which is double-minded? with a positive confession. Mm-hmm. You know, because God wants to transform us. Heaven is inside us. Kingdom of heaven is inside us.
Right.
Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So it's time that we can die to the self, die to the flesh, which we were never created to be.
That's right.
I mean, it's so sad when you live your whole life, you know, and realize it was all an imposter. And God created us for something so much more. You know, it's just like someone who's adopted, I suppose, and they find out they're adopted later. And, you know, everything that you thought was, you know, real about certain things, you find out, well, that wasn't even true.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was created to be someone else, you know.
Come on.
You know, so that's what this is about. Hopefully it inspires us and calls us, you know, farther. And basically, this is just about saying, God, you know, I pray to you. You know, I love you. I worship you. But this is just not enough. I know there's more. Mm-hmm. So this is about getting us connected with more. Anyway, as far as the offering goes, Jesus, thank you for your goodness, your grace, Holy Spirit. Thank you for coming down and offering all you are to us. Jesus, thank you for offering all that you were to us. Help us to receive that. And in memory of that, we give you part of us. You know, through our money, we would need to give you all of us. Because you give us all of you.
Yeah.
And you traded us. That's the best thing. You gave us all that you are, that you achieved. All your godhood, all your superiority, all your power, all your goodness, all your love. You know, and we're created to be a being of love and radiate you. We're created to walk in an image of you. And that's just amazing because of the existence that we were in when you came.
Yes.
Because how fallen we were. We're all selfish, doing our own thing, living for ourselves, trying to live off each other, trying to take, steal, rob, covet. And you've transformed us and bring us into a place where we can be loved.
Thank you,
Lord. So, Lord, as we give our offerings to you, thank you for offering us yourself.
Yes, amen.
Amen.
Yes.
You don't have the right to have a bad day. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. We thank you for your kindness, for your faithfulness, for your goodness, for your grace. I ask you, Lord, just to open our understanding to your word tonight. Open our hearts to receive what the Spirit is saying, that we may embrace you, Lord, through your word and by your Spirit. We give you all the thanks and the praise for all that's been said already tonight by your Spirit. We receive it in Jesus' name. And everybody said, praise the Lord. Praise Amen. Give the Lord a hand tonight. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. Amen. God bless you all. Thank you, Tim. Thank you, Mike. Thanks, Eric, for sharing that. And in fact, some of you may remember, I had to go and check with Sally to be sure when it was. I think it's about 3.5 years ago now when we were out in Colorado visiting friends that used to be a part of the church here. They're now in Arizona, but at that time they were living in Colorado, and we were staying up in Estes Parks with some other friends that, in fact, Jerry and Brennan were the original pastors of this church when it was in the mobile home park out on the south side. He's the one that asked me to take the church. And we were visiting with them, stayed up there with them. They're running a resort, or they were at the time, and we stayed there for a few days. And we sat up one night till God only knows what time and watched 3 or 4 of these DVDs with Todd White and some others. In fact, we brought a couple of them back, and we played them on a Wednesday night here about 3 years ago, 2 years ago, whatever it was. And that resonated with us then, obviously, and it still does today. So we do have at least one of those DVDs, if not a couple of them. So anybody that would like to just spend an hour or so immersing yourself in this, I guarantee you, it will bless you, and it'll provoke you to rethink your Christianity, praise the Lord. Amen. It's not a beat-you-up kind of message, but it's one that does inspire and does draw you out of yourself, praise the Lord. Amen. And that's what it's all about. So appreciate that, Eric. Thanks for sharing that again and quickening some of those things back to us. Amen.
Yes.
God doesn't change his mind. We may get sidetracked and do some other things, but God's still... He's still saying the same thing he was saying 4 years ago. How many know that? He's saying the same thing he was saying 4,000 years ago. Praise God. Hallelujah. All right. Praise the Lord. God bless you all for being here tonight. Appreciate it. Appreciate your testimonies and sharing your prayer requests with us. God bless you. And see, Doug, you're doing just what we all need to do.
Right.
You know? Amen. And we forget sometimes, and you know, a homosexual is no different than a drug addict or alcoholic or abuser of people. They're in bondage. They're prisoners, and they need to be set free. And the only way you can do that is through love.
Right.
I mean, he already knows what he's involved in. So, you know, if a person's really deeply into sin, and I mean, you know, really just going after that, it isn't that they don't have an inner awareness of the fact that they're screwing things up. It's they don't want to have to deal with it. They don't want to admit it. And so, you know, the people that scream the loudest, I don't care about hell, are the people that are thinking about it quite a bit, I'll guarantee you. There's lots of long nights when they wake up at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning wondering, what if there is a hell?
Right.
What if there is a God? What if what that man said to me at the Quick Trip was true? You know, you're planting seeds. You're causing them to reevaluate. And that's what's called repentance. You rethink God. You reimagine God. You reevaluate God. You reconsider what God is all about.
Amen.
Sometimes your being there and sharing that with love is an experience this guy's probably never had. I imagine he's been beat up, you know, emotionally by a lot of people saying what a wicked life you're living and how horrible and how can you do this and what a despicable person and all that, when God is still reaching out to him and wanting to love him, just as you are.
Amen.
He can deal with that issue just the same as he can with any other.
Right.
We just need to get him there to him. Just get the God of love make them available to them. Amen. And that's what you're doing, and God bless you for it. Amen. And God will bless that effort, I guarantee you, because that's something that the Spirit does. Amen. You may not get to see it. You may have to wait to heaven to see this guy. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? But the seed's being sowed, and that's what that seed, amen. The seed is good. Amen. The seed is always good. So you spread the seed. You don't always know what kind of soil you're on, but who cares? That's not our job. We're not soil inspectors. We're seed sowers. Amen. So we just sow the seed and let God take care of the rest of it. Amen. God bless you. Amen. Okay, let's get right to the word tonight. Philippians chapter 3, verse 12. I appreciate Tim's words of encouragement tonight, and they do go along really well with what I feel like the Lord's given me. In fact, everything that we've been talking about tonight, I think, is right on with what the Holy Spirit was giving me over the last few days for tonight. So, praise the Lord. Not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. So, Paul's saying, it's not that I'm perfect. I'm still struggling. I still got some issues. I need to grow in some areas. And I have to continue to follow Jesus. So I press on. Amen? There's a right way to press on, and there's a wrong way. And that's what I want to talk about. The wrong way is, let me control this. Let me manage this. Let me figure out how to make it work naturally. Amen? That's the wrong way. The right way is push headlong into Jesus and then keep pushing. Amen. Praise the Lord. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. We've looked at this scripture frequently. In fact, we just did it Sunday. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even by the Spirit of the Lord. Now, Tim was talking about this being a process. Well, by beholding Jesus, we're transformed by degrees, amen, into the image of Jesus.
Yes.
So the more you behold Jesus, the more you focus on Jesus, the more you're going to be transformed. And it does, you know, sometimes it happens in an instant. Some people have, you know, miraculous transformation, but their life still has to work in degrees. You know what I'm saying? So when we're talking about from glory to glory, we're talking about we're being transformed by degrees, as we behold the Lord, as we focus on Jesus, our life becomes transformed into His likeness. Amen. I was looking when I was reading that. I was just glancing through some scriptures, just kind of, and I saw something. This Bible is, I don't know how old it is. I've been using it for a long time. I've got others that I study with, but I've used this for probably 15, 20 years maybe. So I've got a lot of notes in there that I have to almost not look at because they were so horribly wrong. Praise the Lord. But I thought they were right at the time. But it just shows you how
Revelation
works, you know. It wasn't that it was bad. It wasn't that it was sinful. It was just not very accurate. Praise the Lord. But I did notice something that I had written next to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 4. If you'll go there, Mike. Chapter 5, verse 4. For we that are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened, not for that we would be unclothed, but clothed upon, that mortality might be swallowed up of life. Now, this is really an interesting scripture if you really start looking into it. For we that are in this flesh, in this tabernacle, in this body, right? We groan, being burdened. You know, we talk about hungering for Jesus. That's what this is about. That's the dissatisfaction that we feel, you know, the disconnect. Even though we have been reunited with God, we're still not in sync, and that's what we groan for. That's what we long for. Amen. So, being burdened, not for what we would be, not that we would be unclothed, not that the body would just go away, we would just be a spirit, but that clothed upon, that mortality might be swallowed up of life. And here's the note that I had in there: flesh swallowed up by the Spirit, or dominated by the Spirit, which is God's life. So our humanity, our fleshly life, is swallowed up in the life of God, in the eternity of God, in the reality of God. And isn't that really what this is all about? Being in Christ, right? And Christ in us. So you know, we say that and we know that, but here's the problem.
We're groaning for that reality. We want to be swallowed up in the Spirit of God, swallowed up in God life, instead of natural human stuff, right? So, you remember the old hymn? Years ago, I remember we used to sing this a lot. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. I was thinking of that when Tim was talking. And the things of this earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. That's a beautiful old hymn, but it's true. And that's why a lot of those old hymns are so beautiful, because they were so accurate scripturally, praise the Lord. But that's the truth, and that's Bible. I mean, that comes right from the Bible. Look at John 1:16. Focusing on Jesus, and all the junk in this world grows strangely dim. He becomes greater, bigger, brighter, fuller, and everything else recedes into the shadows of the darkness, praise God, where it belongs, amen. And of his fullness have all we received, and grace for grace, praise the Lord. So there's a grace upon grace to be had, and it's had in Jesus, in him, amen. So much grace that you can't use it all up. Jesus is more than enough. He's everything. In Christ's grace, there is freedom to be honest and to be transparent. I think sometimes people think I say a lot of the things I say because I'm afraid I'll get caught. I've already been busted. You know, God knows me inside and out, so I don't worry about your opinion. I just don't worry too much about what you think, that, you know, maybe I'm not holy enough or spiritual enough or whatever. God already knows, and he's okay right now, so him and I are all right. Amen, so... You're just going to have to get on board with Jesus if you got a problem with me. Praise God. Makes me feel good. Hallelujah. But when we embrace the security and the freedom, that's when we can point others to the only source of healing and forgiveness. Amen. When we understand how free we are and how loved we are and how healed we are in terms of our humanity, then we become real to people that are dealing with the same issues, because everybody's got them. And you're right, Tim. I don't care if they're wearing designer clothes and Rolex watches, or if they got a Timex or a pair of jeans. Inside, we're all the same. We all need God. And sometimes those that have the most actually have the least. Right. They have the most in the natural realm, but they're lacking, sorely lacking. That's why you see so many suicides and horrendous kind of behavior in the wealthy, in the Hollywood elite, and all those kinds of things. It's insane. You think, man, if I had that kind of money, what I could do? No. Yeah. They got the money, but they have no sense of purpose, no reality to this life. Amen. They're just looking at the world itself and thinking that's all that there is. This is it. So make it count, right? Do good. Get a bunch. Get more. Amen. But that source is not, when it comes to freedom and deliverance, the source of that isn't self-improvement projects.
Right.
It's finished work of Christ. There's nothing wrong with us wanting to be good people and should, and moral people, but we're going to fail at that. So if we make that the criteria by which we're judging and critiquing ourselves, we're going to see ourselves as failures all the time, because we're going to screw it up. So it's not about... The focus isn't on us improving ourselves. The focus is on Jesus, and degree by degree, we are transformed. As long as the focus is on me, I'm going to keep messing it up and screwing it up and twisting it and trying to manipulate the thing to work for me. If my focus is on Jesus, Jesus will do the work.
Yes.
And it's a perfect work in Christ. Amen? Yeah. So, Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. Have you ever heard this? I used to use this when I was really wanted to mess with somebody. Call him son. This is back when I was 20s, 30s in the Marine, when I was in the Marine Corps. And you'd say something like this. I call you son. Not because you shine, but because you're mine. I mean, like I can control you, you know, I can manipulate, I can muscle you, I can get over on you. Anybody ever hear that expression? Mm-hmm. I call you son, not because you shine, but because you're mine?
Yep.
Okay. Well, okay, so you did, praise the Lord, but I'm a lot older than most of you. Okay, thank you, Alvin. The only one in here close, praise God. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. In Christ. Yes. According as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy without blame before him in love.
Yes.
Praise God. Well, my experience has been, and this is, I'm not speaking particularly of this body, but of religious people or Christians, I guess, generally, the longer somebody's been in church, the more difficult believing this truth becomes.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Amen. Because we have been so regimented in the ways of Christianity and religion that it almost seems blasphemous. Which isn't that what they called Jesus when he came to reconnect us to God?
Yep.
Praise God. The more difficult this truth becomes. Some have been in church so long that they've been doing this good Christian thing for so long, self-effort, the trying to be a better person on their own, but the idea that they were chosen and determined for blamelessness before they had started earning credit is offensive to them. But think about that. We have been chosen by God and determined by God for blamelessness before we ever did anything, and in spite of a lot of what we had already done. We've got people that are in bondage, Christians, because they cannot see this. They can't embrace it. In our flesh, we tend to think that our holiness is the result of what we used to call elbow grease.
Mm-hmm.
Only in this case, it's spiritual elbow grease. And it's just not true. I'm not contradicting the fact that we want to be morally good people. We want to be right behaving people. But that's not the criteria that God uses to judge us. He's chosen us when we were filthy rags.
Come on.
When every good thing that we tried to do was trash and unspeakable to God.
Come on.
And yet he embraces us.
Thank you, Lord.
And cleanses us. Amen. And makes us white as snow. Amen. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 4 and 6. According as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy without blame before him in love. Right? He's determined that we're going to be blameless. Having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved. I mean, you want to meditate something? Meditate this.
Yes.
Mutter this. Talk to yourself about this.
Yes.
This is coming from God. This is what God says. This is what God's done. And it's what he's doing. Amen?
Amen?
So if you think that there's no way to follow Jesus like this, if you think that there's no way to know Jesus like this, if you just think there's no way to walk with Jesus like this, if you think there's no way to experience Jesus like this, simply because you're still struggling, because you still have issues, you still fail. This text refutes every bit of that. Every bit of self-doubt, every bit of self-incrimination, every bit of demonic influence and oppression is denied and refuted right there in three verses. And you could go throughout the Bible and find it, but those are three that are just really in your face, the truth.
Yep.
Praise God. I would to God that every Christian could know this in their heart. And I guarantee you it would transform not only that those individuals, but it would transform the body of Christ and thereby change this world.
Amen.
Praise God. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 4 and 6 again, Mike. I'm sorry, we're still there. According as he's chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy without blame before him. It staggers me. I mean, this just takes my breath away. Honest to God. According as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. I mean, he didn't do it like somebody was twisting his arm or it made him sick to have to do it. It was his pleasure. It was his good pleasure to do it. Made him feel good. Makes him feel good. If I could use that kind of talk of language of the Lord. But having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved. Praise God. God rescues the dirty to the praise of his glorious grace. Hallelujah.
Glory.
It's the same gracious dynamic that you see when God says to a little harp-playing shepherd boy by the name of David, you're mine. Not because you shine. I call you son. Not because you shine. Not because you're so wonderful, but because you're mine. To David, the murderous adulterer, you're mine. To Moses, the unqualified, stuttering murderer, you're mine. To Paul, the murderer and persecutor of Christ, you're mine.
Yes.
And in response, Paul becomes the man driven to basically say this in Philippians 3, verse 8, where we read. Doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but garbage, that I may win Christ. Praise God. My best efforts are garbage compared to the righteousness that's given to me by grace and promised before time began. That's powerful. You want to feel something? I feel the Holy Ghost.
Come on.
Praise God.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. The Bible is primarily about grace. I mean, it's staggering that this holy God of the universe would say, mine. You're mine. And say it about sinners. And lay hold of them in love. And that's what he said in Isaiah 61. It's what he said in Luke 4. For this purpose, God sent me. So send I you. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7. Thing I love about it is you can just be you. You can just be the strange, the different, the unique, the who you are in Christ and have such a dramatic effect on people. In fact, God would have it no other way. He created you uniquely, you, for that purpose. In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. So we're redeemed through what? Our effort? No. Christ's blood. We're forgiven of our sins according to what? Our moral credit? No. The riches of his grace. When you look at people, the homosexual at the Quick Trip, pardon my French, the gutter slut, you know, on the corner, the drunks in the street, the blasphemers, the curse. Redeemed by his blood.
Yes.
Forgiven by the riches of his grace. Praise the Lord. John chapter 6. I want to read about 12 verses here, 57 through 69, Mike. John 6, verses 57 through 69. I think this is really a good scripture because it makes me think of me, you know. As the living Father has sent me and I live by the Father, so he that eateth me, even he shall live by me. This is that bread which came down from heaven, not as your fathers did eat manna and are dead. He that eateth of this bread shall live forever. These things said he in the synagogue as he taught in Capernaum. Many therefore of his disciples, when they had heard this, said, "This is a hard saying. Who can hear it?" When Jesus knew in himself that his disciples murmured at it, he said unto them, "Does this offend you? What if ye shall see the Son of Man ascend up where he was before? It is the Spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. But there are some of you that believe not, for Jesus knew from the beginning who they were that believed not and who should betray him. And he said, therefore said I unto you, that no man can come unto me except it were given unto him of my Father. From that time many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. Then said Jesus unto the 12, will you also go away? Now, let me just, before I wrap this up, just think about this. He's talking to people, Jews, who had lived their entire lives based on rules, what they had to do in order to be accepted by God. Now, he's saying that man that came down from heaven didn't come down because you were so good. It came down because God had pity on you. He had mercy on you, and he wanted to take care of you. Right? But he said even that manna was only good for a while. It satisfied the flesh,
right,
which was going to die. Mm-hmm. But I'm the manna that came down from heaven. And if you partake of this, if you get me into you, you'll have God life.
There you go.
Eternal life. And it aggravated, it made him mad. It made him mad because it took them out of the equation.
Right.
Okay, so then he goes on, he said, you know, this is a hard thing to swallow. And he says, well, are you going to leave too? Then Simon Peter answered him and said, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. So the disciples are still going to struggle. They're still going to have problems. They're going to have a tough time with the mission of Jesus for quite a while after this.
Right.
They'll constantly get things wrong. But in the moment, in that moment, they got it right. To whom would we go?
Yeah.
Where do we go if it's not to you? Everywhere else we go is going to be disaster for us. Any answer but Jesus is no answer.
Right.
Yet when we run, when we turn, when we go away, his grace continues to reach us.
Yes.
And again, not to belabor the issue there with the guy at the Quick Trip, but see, the guy's running. He's in a dead run, like his hair's on fire, and God's still reaching for him.
Yes. Yes.
And Doug, you might think, like most of us would, well, who am I to be doing this, right? You're the vehicle, baby. You are the means by which God reaches this guy. And he's not ashamed to call you brother.
Right.
He's not ashamed to say, this is my son. Right. He's mine. Not because he shines, but because he's mine. He's my son. Praise God. Galatians chapter 3, verse 3. He says to the Galatians, having begun in the Spirit, are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, that now you're going to try to carry this thing out in the flesh? You're so foolish, having begun in the Spirit, now are you now made perfect by the flesh? Having been saved by grace and drawn by the Spirit of God, are you going to now work the works of God by the flesh?
There it is.
Are you going to reach somebody else differently than you were reached? It's Spirit, beginning to end.
Amen.
For eternity. Philippians 2:13. I love that, what he said in the video. You get up in the morning, you say, who do you want me to talk to today? Anybody.
Right.
Everybody.
Exactly.
Where do you want me to go? Just go. Everybody. Wherever you go, go.
Yep.
What do you want me to say? Just open your mouth and let me say it.
Yes.
Just be available.
Yes.
It's not hard. It's not complicated. It just takes a little courage. It just takes a little boldness to be willing to step out there. But if you know that you're in Christ and that Christ is in you, as he said, what do you got to be afraid of? If God's for you, who cares who's against you?
That's right.
For it's God which worketh in you,
yeah,
both to will and to do of his good pleasure.
Yes.
Yes.
Thank God. Praise the Lord. John 15, verse 16. You have not chosen me, I've chosen you. You're my son. Not because you shine, because you're mine.
Come on.
Amen. And ordained you,
yes,
that you should go and bring forth fruit.
Yes.
And that your fruit should remain.
Yes.
That whatsoever you shall ask of the Father in my name, give it to you.
Yes.
You're asking for this man to be saved.
Woo.
I believe he's going to be saved. I don't know that we'll see it. I don't know that he'll come here and make a profession of faith. But he's going to somewhere because God sent somebody. God himself went in somebody to get him.
Come on.
Because God's saying, you're mine.
Yes. Yeah.
Not because you've got a beautiful life, not because you're so attractive, not because you're such a wonderful human, not because you've got your ducks all in a row, but because you're mine. I have chosen you.
Come
on. Praise God. 1 John 4:19. You know, right after that scripture, just a couple of verses, if I'm not mistaken, it says, whose sins you forgive, I'll forgive. I think I can just forgive the guy his homosexual tendencies and just love him in Jesus.
Amen.
God will do the same thing. You understand the power that God has given us? We talk about, you know, having authority. My God, is there any authority greater than that? That you can say, your sins are forgiven? Based, and we say it, in fact, because it's based on knowing that God has already forgiven if you'll just receive it.
Yep.
I mean, he died before the foundation of the world for this guy, the same as he did us. It's not like he's waiting for this guy, and then he's going to die.
Come on.
He already died for him.
Yes.
He just needs a little of us to die.
Come on.
Our flesh, I'm talking about.
Yes.
Get it out of the way, that we may bring life. And that more abundantly. We love him because he first loved us.
Right.
Praise the Lord. 1 John chapter 4. Oh, that is 1 John 4:19. I'm sorry. I get ahead of myself sometimes. So, we loved him because he first loved us. So, if we go back to return back to the total justification that we have in Christ, declared before the foundation of the world, in the predestined purpose of God, That's where you'll find the power to press on. That's what Paul learned. We have to continually go back to the gospel. We have to go back to that reality, to that truth. That's the thing that has to stay before us. If we're going to do this, if we're going to be successful, if we're going to be in Christ, I mean, in any tangible way, I know we are, but I'm saying in any way that really makes a difference to anybody else and to ourselves, this is how it's done. You have to go back to the total justification that we have been declared righteous in Christ before the foundation of the world. We have a predestined purpose. Amen? And the purpose really, if I could simplify it, it would be to be in Christ. And everything else would take care of itself. If you're really linked up with Jesus, if you're really one with Christ, stuff just happens. You don't have to make it happen. That's what he's saying when he says, who do I talk to? Anybody. Where do I go? Just go. This is a purpose of God. This is a plan of God. It's not yours. It's like he told Abraham, he said, go to a place. And I'll tell you where it is when you get there. Where do I go? Just go. Why? Because wherever you put the sole of your foot, it's yours. Amen? Just go, because whoever you come into contact with, I want them. They're mine. I want them to be my son. I just need you to go. There's not a shortage of places to go. There's not a shortage of people to reach out to. They're everywhere.
Glory.
And it's in that you find the power to do what Paul said, and that is press in to Jesus.
Yes.
The ability to go on, to keep on keeping on, to go deeper into Christ,
Glory.
To see more revealed of Christ. Wouldn't it be wonderful if it was revealed in us instead of on a platform somewhere or in a video,
Right. But
in your own life? All right, Philippians chapter 3, verses 12 through 16. We're about done here. Philippians 3, 12 through 16. Not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect. But I follow after that, if that I may apprehend that for which also I'm apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Let us therefore, as many as be perfect. You say, well, that's not me. Yes, it is you. That's what he's telling you. In him, you're perfect. In the eyes of God, you're good. Amen? So, as many as may be perfect, or as many as be perfect, be thus minded. Think that way.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And if anything, ye be otherwise minded, if you're not thinking that way, God will reveal even this unto you.
Mm-hmm.
If you'll listen, if you'll let him. Keep that up there for just a second, if you can, Mike. Let us therefore, as may be perfect, be thus minded, and if anything be otherwise minded, God shall reveal this. Okay, so I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. I press toward the mark. That's present tense. Right? It's happening right now. I press on, present tense, because Christ has made, past tense, me, his own.
Yes.
I'm doing what I'm doing now because of what Jesus already has done.
Yes.
That's why we press on, because of what he did.
Yeah.
Because it's already done.
Yeah.
Not because if I keep pressing, I may get more attention and God will like me better. No, I press in, I press on into Christ because of what Christ has already done. Not what I'm expecting that he will do if I do it. That's my identity. It's your identity as a believer. Praise God. Can you back up, if you will, Mike, back up to 12? Not as though I had already attained, neither were already made perfect. I follow after that. I may apprehend that for which also I'm apprehended. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting the things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. 14. I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Let us therefore, as many as be perfect, be thus minded. And if anything ye be otherwise minded, God shall reveal even this. Praise the Lord. Everywhere, everything, let us hold true to what we have attained. I think that's the way to say it. Let us stay faithful to what we already got. I'm not doing stuff to get it. I'm just focusing on Jesus, staying focused on Christ. Why? Because of what I already have. Because of what he's already done. It's a whole different mindset, if I'm making any sense to you. It's not trying to get there. It's moving on from there, from where we've already been, from what he's already done.
Yes.
You have to return to the gospel over and over and over. It's critical if you're going to pursue Christ.
Yep.
That's the reason for the grace message, not because we're trying to give everybody a free pass to be idiots. It's so that you can understand what's been done, so that you can press into Christ, so you can feel his arms open to you, so that you can know that he loves you and wants to be one with you.
Mm-hmm.
He's done everything that's necessary for that to be a reality. It's just a question of us believing it and acting upon it.
Right.
You can't pursue Christ otherwise.
Right.
The gospel is where the power is. It's the power of God unto salvation, unto sozo, unto everything that the kingdom is about.
Yes.
It's not just getting out of hell, which is a great thing, but I mean, it's not the only thing. It's just a thing. God keeps loving us. He keeps empowering us. He keeps satisfying us. He keeps sanctifying us despite our ongoing issues. Paul said, I got problems, I got troubles, I got struggles, but I'm pressing on because of what he's done.
Yep.
Not like I've already arrived, not like I've already got it all perfectly right and just it's all great, but the issue is Christ, not me.
Yep.
It's Christ and him crucified.
Yep.
God keeps loving us anyway. He keeps empowering us in spite of us. Romans 8, 22 through 24. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope, for what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for it? All right, we can answer this with 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7. For we walk by faith, not by sight. Praise the Lord. So here's what I'm saying tonight. I'm finishing. What the scripture's saying is join up with the men and the women throughout the Bible, with creation itself, in groaning for our gracious God. Don't stop. Keep pressing on. The race is not to the swift, but to the ones who endure to the end. Hey, there's a prize. And guess what? It's Jesus. And you can win it here in this life. You can experience it here in this life, but you have to stay in the race. You have to keep pressing on, not on your, out of your own abilities and strength, but out of what Christ has already done for us. Amen. He has laid hold of you, and he won't let go. So walk by faith and not by flesh, and you'll see fruit. Praise the Lord. It'll be good fruit. Because it's coming from the vine.
Amen.
Hallelujah. The master gardener, praise God. The one who says, you're my son. Not because you shine. Because you're mine. Praise the Lord. Go ahead.
I know flesh is not our body flesh, but can you give a good description of dying to the flesh?
Your flesh.
To walk in the spirit.
The flesh is the natural way of thinking. Senses. It's your soul, if you will, in some respects, because it's how you perceive things. It's how you respond to things in the natural. So, for example, I get up this morning, and I'm sneezing, coughing, and I say, got a cold. That's the flesh. The Spirit says, by his stripes you were healed. That's the Spirit. That's walking by faith. Now, I'm not saying it's perfect. I'm not saying I'm perfect at it either. But I'm saying the words of my mouth have to conform to what's in my heart. Because out of the mouth, the abundance of the heart speaks. So when you catch yourself saying things like, oh, God doesn't care about this, or God's not interested in that, that's the flesh. And it's evidence that we're not in Christ, I guess is the way of saying it. Now, don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying people are not saved when they do that. I'm saying you can't be, if you're operating that way, you're at enmity or at odds with God. Not that God doesn't love you and care for you, but you put yourself in a position where God cannot do what God wants to do. And you won't see it manifest what God has already done. Because he still gives you authority to operate in this world.
Double-minded.
And you get nothing. It doesn't mean that you're not saved. It just means that your mind is not one with your spirit. And, we all know, you can't say something that doesn't go through your head. You've got to have a thought before you can verbalize it. You've got to have a thought before you can act. So that's the renewing of the mind. When we're talking about renewing the mind, people think, well, that just you just memorize a bunch of scripture. That ain't going to do it. If you don't know what the scripture's saying, it doesn't do you any good to memorize it. Right? I mean, I could memorize equations of Einstein, but I could never explain relativity in the way that he understood it. Right? I mean, I can read something biochemistry. I could read the book, but I don't really understand the book, so I'm not going to be able to explain it to anybody else or be able to use it in a way that's going to have any value to me. Do you understand what I'm saying? So it isn't enough to just read Scripture or memorize Scripture. We need to see what the Holy Spirit is saying to us through that Scripture.
Exactly. Revelation.
Revelation is the word. Exactly. It comes alive. It becomes not just words. Jesus said, I read it at the very beginning of this, the words that I speak, they're spirit and they're life. And we read them like it's a textbook. It's just information. But until we see it as spirit and life, it's difficult to act on it in a way that's going to have any meaningful effect. And again, it comes back to being, to be in Christ, and I'm just saying this. To be in Christ is to be led by the Spirit. It's the Spirit of Christ that's in you. It's the Holy Spirit. They're one and the same. Christ in you, the hope of glory. He wants our life to be lived vicariously through by Christ. In other words, all this stuff about us dying is true. We just don't like it. Yeah. We are new creations when we're dragging around a corpse. You know, and trying to make it do stuff that it cannot do. It's dead, it stinks, it's worthless, it's of no value. The only value that the body has is give us legitimacy in this world.
The natural mind is enmity towards God.
Exactly, it's at odds with God. It isn't that it hates God or that God hates it, it's just that they can't mesh. Well, you know, what the Bible says is that the mind is the battlefield, where Satan comes to attack. Look, he has no power over you spiritually, none whatsoever. You are as perfect in the spirit as you'll ever be. You're as perfect as Christ in the spirit. The only way he can get to you is through the senses, through the flesh. So either it's pain, it's fear. It's anxiety, it's stress, it's, God's mad at me, God doesn't love me. That's the reason for going back over and over and over to the gospel that we just talked about tonight. That has to be uppermost, foremost in our minds if we're going to be able to defeat the enemy. Amen. You have to, see, we talk about, well, if God is for you, who can be against you? Well, we think of that in terms of humanity, which is true. The ultimately, we're talking about the enemy here, the devil. If God's for me, I'm not worried about the devil and all his junk. We spend more time talking about the devil than we do about God, and it's no wonder then he's able to manipulate us and intimidate us.
Well, God's trying to recreate us into his image. That's the whole purpose of Jesus coming back.
Right.
And the purpose of the Holy Spirit, who's our comforter, because it's probably pretty uncomfortable to be transformed out of the flesh, into Adam's knowledge of man. So God's trying to recreate us into his image, right? For a spirit to be first and foremost. Satan's trying to do the opposite, to recreate us into his image,
right,
which is the fallen image of man, which is the flesh, which is the carnal nature, which will express the fruit of himself, which is fear, doubt, envy, anger, malice. I mean, it speaks about the Bible. God's fruit, the fruit of the Spirit, as we're coming into Christ.
Peace, love, joy. Yeah.
Expressing the fruit of the Spirit. Love. You look at love in Corinthians, what it says. That's how we're supposed to measure ourselves.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
That's what they mean when they say carnal Christianity. We
yeah.
have a confession of God, but we're expressing these fruits of Satan.
Exactly. Satan. And that's being double-minded as much as saying, right. I love the Lord, and I believe God's got everything under control, and then, look what the devil's doing, and my life is a total disaster, and I don't know what's going to happen, and everything's going to fall apart, and everything's terrible. That's natural. It's normal. And look, here's the other thing too, Doug. Look at it this way. The devil is one being. Now, there's lots of spirits, there's imps, there's all this other junk. But believe me, the devil isn't focused on you. He's got bigger fish to fry. Yes. Well, he may have Hillary, I don't know. But maybe he has Donald too. I don't know any of that. But what I'm saying is, he that's in you is greater than he that's in the world. I don't care who that is. Yeah.
Just cast those thoughts down. When it comes against the word of God, you're supposed to cast those down. Don't
rise up in your mind. I would say this. Instead of, on the one hand, we are people that, by nature, I mean, spiritually speaking, we always looking for more revelation. But the problem is we haven't embraced the revelation we have to the extent that it will impact us in a way. So we're always looking for another quick fix. But there isn't a quick fix. The quick fix was done 2,000 years ago, and actually before the foundation of the world, and that's what we have to go back and go back and go back and keep going back and focusing on that in order to see what our identity really is. Because we've got this schizophrenic Christianity that we know on the one hand who we are in Christ, but we live our lives disconnected from that and wonder why it's so messed up and why everything is so screwed up.
Go
You understand what I'm saying? And what Christianity has done as a rule is then try to fix you up on the outside. Regardless of how screwed up you are inside, we just want to make you look presentable, and then that's all there is to it. Well, that's the devil's game. I mean, that's what the devil always does. It's all external. It's all on the outside. It's all the flesh. Amen. We've played right into his hands. I mean, the church in general has. And so we've got all of these people who most are probably born again, but they're living so below their true identity and the authority that they have in Christ that they go through their, and that causes, listen, that causes big problems. This isn't just about reaching the lost or presenting Christ. It's about people living way down to where they are constantly being, they're constantly questioning their own salvation, if they're even saved or not, because they're not seeing fruit. And they know deep down inside, the stuff I'm doing this. I'm really working hard at it because I want to do the right thing, right? But because we don't keep going back to these basic truths, we never get past them. That's why he says, leaving the doctrines of baptism and this and the other, let's press on. Let's move into what we're really here for now. There's enough of that. We've had enough of that. Let's move in and let Christ take over. Exactly.
We're not even doing the elementary thing.
And I've heard other people say, well, you know, that's just basic stuff, you know, the grace and that. It's just basic. Listen, that, it may be, it's like someone said, it's not just the ABCs of Christianity. It's the A to Z of Christianity, because without that, you don't have anything else. Without that understanding, everything else gets distorted. Everything else gets perverted. And then it becomes open to anybody's interpretation. Whoever gets in the pulpit, whoever has a Bible, they can start twisting it to say whatever they want it to say to fit whatever their denomination is, whatever their particular creed, and so on and so forth is. It was never meant to be that way. There wasn't supposed to be any denomination. There was just supposed to be a church, just a body of Christ.
So Satan's only trick, which he does through, you know, a lot of means, but is to get us to, like judo, he uses our own power against us to keep us, you know, without power.
Exactly. Which is what he did with Adam and Eve from the very beginning. The authority that they had, he used it against them. He had them use it against themselves. And so that's why this Philippians is a great book. I mean, you ought to really take some time to spend there, because Paul is... You know, Paul. We look at Paul and we go, oh, we got hindsight, so we're saying, man, what a man of God. This guy had issues like everybody else does. But his whole purpose was to be one with Christ, to be found in him. The one who came into him, he wanted to get into him. You understand what I'm saying? He's saying, yeah, I know I've got God in me. I want in him. I want to be the means by which he operates in this earth. And we just think, I just want to get born again so I don't go to hell and maybe God will give me some freebies in this world and everything will be cool. That's not what it's about. Those things happen as a result of being in Christ.
Amen.
And him being in you. That's the point. That's what we're after. And look, so this isn't an indictment of anybody, and this certainly is not a criticism of anybody. It's saying, come on, this is what the Holy Spirit is saying to us. I think that's why, you know, we talk about the grace revolution. Well, I think that's the reason for the grace revolution is because without that, we can't get to where God wants us to be. We cannot operate in Christ in any meaningful, consistent way without a complete understanding and acceptance of God's acceptance of us, of the finished work that is already done in terms of who we are in him. That way we have boldness now to come to the throne of grace. We can come out into the world without fear, knowing that he that's in us is greater, that he's for us, that he can do the work. He just needs a vehicle. He just needs us for this body I'm talking about.
A vessel.
The body gives you legitimate rights on this planet. God designed it that way. God made it that way. That's why we're here. That's why we're still in a body. The body gives us legal residence on planet Earth. Gives us a right to dominate in this realm. The devil is a usurper. He's the guy behind the curtain. He's the guy that comes in and has to manipulate people. He's got to use people too.
Yeah.
He's got to have somebody to do his dirty work. Got to have somebody that's legitimate here. And how many people, I mean, we know people that are walking in Satan. You know what I'm saying?
Yep. Yep.
That's why we have to be in Christ. In Christ, you are, see, all these scriptures we talked about, more than a conqueror, always victorious. Read, go back and read them. In Christ. Outside of Christ, it's a crapshoot, man.
Yep. Amen.
But in Christ, you can be guaranteed the consistency of the Word of God will be there every single time in Christ, if you're operating in Christ.
You
can do no other thing. But that, again, that's the reason why we keep going back. Keep going back to those fundamentals, what we call fundamentals, because without them, you can't operate in Christ.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Lord.
Christ is not freed to do what only Christ can do.
Can I read something to you?
Please do.
This is from Billy Graham, The Authority of the Believer, and how to use it. So I'm asking the Lord how to use it, because I've been stole from for a long time, the last 9 years. Takes a quote from John A. McMillan, who went to be with the Lord in 1956. So he was an old boy. But he had a comment back then, and this is 1956. He says, "The rapidly approaching end of the age is witnessing a tremendous increase in the activity of the powers of darkness. To meet this situation, the Church of Christ needs a new conception of prayer. The urgent call is for men and women wholly yielded to the Lord, whose eyes have been enlightened to see the ministry in the heavenlies to which they have been called. Such believers may, in union with the great head of the body, exercise an authority to which the powers of the air must give place wherever challenged." And so I'm thinking, Lord, if that was in 1956, how much more evil is it today than it was then?
Well, yeah, and I think, and I'm going to close so you don't.
But I'm wanting what you said.
No, I know what you're saying.
I want to hear from him as
what I'm saying. I think we complicate things.
Yeah.
You know, we make it more complex than it is. That's all true what he said, but the simple answer is in Christ.
In Christ.
Say the same thing.
It's not about us. Yeah, that's what he was saying. He just said it in a more elaborate way.
Yeah.
But I, you know, what I'm saying is, because the reason for all this is, when you start kind of seeing it that way, it's again, it starts becoming about us. And it's not about us, it's about him. Our function is to be in him. Just be in Christ.
Amen.
And all, I mean, if you look at all of the books that are being written, all of the tape series and everything else, if they're legitimate, I mean, if they're sincerely trying to bring the church into the place it's supposed to be, they're saying the same thing, they're just doing it in a different way. They're all just, they've got their own verbiage, their own kind of language in the way that they're saying. And maybe they don't know.
And everything gets so distorted that by the time it gets down to the average person sitting in the view, they don't know what's going on. They don't know what to think. Is it me? Is it you? Is it God? Is he mad? Does he want us? Does he doesn't want us? It just gets so complex. And this thing is for babies. Now, we said, it's up for little children to come unto me. I know that's literal, but there's a metaphor here, too. For the young in Christ, is what I said, the new believer, hey, it's not complicated to them. They don't have all the other baggage. They don't have 20 years of, they don't have 20 years of religion to unravel. So they can just press into it. They can, there's ways for them, it seems like they get more grace. It's not that, it's just that they just walk in it. They don't know not to take it, right? They haven't been taught that it's about them. They just receive it. They're thinking, my God, this is outrageous. I mean, I remember when I got born again. I thought, this is crazy. What took me so long? I mean, why did I have to screw around for 30 years? Because I thought it was all about me.
And then everybody else started putting it.
And then, yeah, and it wasn't long before everybody started affirming that false belief. Yes, exactly. No. But I'm saying, see what I'm saying? I'm just being, it's really not complicated. It's not complicated. We complicate it. He has accepted us into the blood. We're good. We're perfect. We're righteous. We're holy. We're set. We're set for what? For Christ to operate on this planet the way he intended, the way he did, the way God did with Adam in the first place.
Amen.
So you're saying as our heart grows closer to Christ and that through that relationship, we see in the mirror dimly, but we see him as he is, we become more like him.
Exactly.
And then as we do that, out of the abundance of our heart, our mouth speaks, mm-hmm. not the opposite way, where we try to speak out of our mouth until the heart receives it. We got to fill it in our heart, then our mouth will speak.
Right. We've been running around saying all kinds of stuff trying to get the heart to agree.
Yeah.
It won't do it.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what he's talking about in chapter 3, verse 18 of 2 Corinthians, where he says, you know, we're being transformed as we behold him. As we keep the focus on him, by degrees, we're being transformed into his likeness. Amen.
Amen.
Same thing that Eric just said in another scripture where it says that we behold him, and as we behold him, we are transformed into that image. Or we behold him, and the next thing you know, we're like him.
Yes.
We see ourselves